Welcome to Journeys Through Sociology, a series of interviews with presidents of the International Sociological Association. I'm Lalibe Bohanyan, and our guest today is Piotr Stomka, who was president of the ISA from 2002 to 2006. Dr. Stomka is a professor of sociology and the head of the chair of theoretical sociology at the Jagiellonian University at Krakow in Poland, from where he is joining us today. Throughout his career, he has published 30 books and over 200 articles, which have been translated into many languages. His textbook for sociology is used throughout Poland's universities and sociology courses, and alongside a long history of involvement in Polish sociology, he's also had an illustrious international career with visiting professorships all over the world, including Mexico, Argentina, Australia, and throughout Europe. In particular, he's had extensive engagement in U.S. sociology, having taught there for many, many years and developing long-standing working relationships with American sociologists like Robert Merton. He has made enormous contributions in sociological theory and philosophy of the social sciences, and his more recent interests have focused on visual sociology and the sociology of everyday life. Thank you so much for joining us today, Professor Stomka.
Hello, Lalek. It is a great privilege to talk to you. I have only one problem. I don't know if I should say good morning or good evening, because in Krakow now in Poland we have full evening and you are just after breakfast, I understand.
Yeah, so good morning and good evening to you. So, Professor Stomka, I'd like to actually begin with the question of how you began your journey through sociology. Which in your case, I think, is an interesting question, given that I've heard you say that in your youth, you didn't even really know sociology existed, and it was introduced to you in your studies in law initially. So can you begin by talking a bit about what it was that drew you to sociology?
Sure. Well, I was living in a country in which sociology was restored only in 1956, after a long period of non-existence in the academy. We had pre-war sociology, but later, under socialist regime, it was considered a competitor to Marxism-Leninism and therefore not taught at the universities. So when I came to start my academic studies, it was 1961, and at that time sociology was only 5 years old in Poland, in all universities already, with some important scholars around, like Zygmunt Bauman, for example. He was teaching at Warsaw University at that time, and I was using his textbooks already at that time. But first I started to study law because I was looking for some field which would give very wide possibilities later. I did not want to limit my prospects. I thought perhaps about becoming a journalist, and law seemed to be a good starting point. And then during the legal studies at the first or second year, I have heard somebody talking about sociology. That was the first time that I ever heard the name and the idea. And I got fascinated. And it was also a year when a very important Polish sociologist, Stanisław Ossowski, published a very important milestone in Polish sociology called On the Peculiarities of the Social Sciences. Excellent, wonderful study of those huge differences existing between natural sciences and social sciences. And that was my first reading in sociology, and I got enthusiastic about it. I felt that is something which, on the one hand, fulfills my aspirations to study wide issues of politics, of society, of economy, of human life in general. Plus, it was the opening of the door or window to the wider world. Sociology was an international discipline, already so much developed in the West, in the US, in many other countries. And for somebody living in Poland at that time, it was important to study something which would open me the world. And in fact, it worked. I combined my studies in sociology with rather intensive study of English language, because language was also a tool to escape to the world, living in Poland, because I have never thought about emigrating. This is my country, I'm attached to that, to the place, to the landscape, to the people. So I never thought about emigrating.
Actually, you know, Professor Stomko, I think is one of the interesting questions that I'd like to pose to you. You know, you talk about the ways in which growing up in communist Poland, there was, in a sense, a kind of isolation from the larger world and your own yearnings to kind of explore the world beyond Poland, which sociology clearly offered a means for doing so, and you've gone on to spend, you know, many years throughout different, you know, parts of the world. And so in many ways you are truly an international sociologist. And at the same time you remained very kind of firmly committed to being grounded in Poland and to always kind of returning there, working there, being really, you know, engaged in Polish sociology. So how do you kind of negotiate or juggle, or is it a juggle, those two?
No,
roles?
I think there is no contradiction between identities, between national identity, local identity, and cosmopolitan identity, European, but in my case also Anglo-Saxon to a great extent, because I had very early opportunity to start my contacts with American social science, as you mentioned in the introduction, and that came exactly 40 years ago. And by the way, it is especially interesting that you are talking to me from Berkeley, because it was Berkeley which was the first place that I have known in the United States, coming there as a Fulbright Fellow in 1972. And I was at that time discovering directly American sociology, which I knew, of course, from books, from second-hand sources, but discovering it at the center of sociological thought, Berkeley, as it is now. At that time, it was also one of the absolutely top schools of sociology. And there I met my first American mentor and teacher, Neil Smelser, who is still around. Mm-hmm. And at Barrows Hall, I remember his office, and I remember how he suddenly put a lot of trust in the young beginning scholar from Poland who was just after his PhD, but nobody in the world. And I remember how Smelser was open, how he invited me, for example, to his classes to teach one of his classes when he was sitting in the audience for graduate students. He wanted me to teach about Karl Marx, assuming quite rightly that I know a little bit about the great German philosopher. So that was my, you know, first encounter with American students. And then at Berkeley, I also did something which I still believe was my biggest achievement. Namely, I decided to write my first book in English. And I was sitting there at a very humble environment of a retirement house, because it was the cheapest way, famous Shattuck Hotel on Shattuck Avenue, where I was sitting in a small room for 8 months and typing on a little typewriter my first English language book, which later was published by Academic Press New York and opened the door to other invitations, to next invitations, and also opened a tremendous life chance which I had of meeting Robert K. Merton, because it happened that the book got in the hands of Robert K. Merton when I was already back in Poland. And knowing, of course, that I can't just come to talk to him at Manhattan, at Riverside Drive, at his apartment, he invited me to Columbia University. Again, the gesture of trust, a tremendous gesture. And he invited me to teach at Columbia during summer sessions, 5 years in a row, during which I have developed very close attachment to the great master. He became really my personal great American master, and we have kept in touch till the end of his days for 20 or more years later. So that was really my window to the wider world, which worked, because both English and sociology turned out to be the keys opening the doors. And of course, later, my country was open, and later it was completely different. I was just like every other sociologist in the democratic world, able to travel, to meet, to become involved in ISA. From a long time, I have been more than 20 some years in some bodies of ISA, etc., etc.
Professor Stomka, so as you say, I mean, it worked. Clearly, in your case, it absolutely worked in terms of your career. But when you think back on that career, what would you identify as some of the real obstacles that you've had as a sociologist, which, I mean, already from what you've shared with us as you know, being a sociologist in communist Poland and then in the transition to post-communist Poland. So what have been some of those challenges for you?
Well, the challenge in the earlier time, before Poland joined the free countries of the world, was simply to get away to America, because that was full of various obstacles. You had to get a permission, a passport, you could not take any money away, you were totally dependent on money coming from the US, for example, by means of scholarship or some other type of help. Those were the problems, and waiting for the decision of the authorities, which could be good but could be bad for you, was always very unpleasant period during that time. I somehow managed to have good invitations from good universities, and I was lucky because Poland was different from many other countries of the region in terms of the rigidity of the regime. Polish scholars were traveling around, Polish artists were traveling around the world. We had access to foreign books, newspapers, and etc. It was a different world than, say, Eastern Germany or Romania or Soviet Union. So that was not a very heroic story, but it was a challenge. And later, welcoming the incredible change which came with Polish Revolution of 1989 and the whole period from 1981, from the revolution of Solidarność and Gdańsk and Wałęsa, etc. And then 10 years still of some tug of war between the regime and the pro-democratic movement. And then the break of 1989, when in a period of days, I have witnessed absolutely fundamental, radical, deep and comprehensive social change. And that created for me a challenge for my academic work. No, life, not life challenge anymore, but to be a witness of revolution firsthand, so to say, has led me to a deeper study of social change, but particularly social change coming from below, social movements, the way that people mobilize, the moments when people who have been living more or less quietly for a long time suddenly decide to go to the streets, and at that moment no regime can in fact resist. And I was witnessing to that, and that led me to the book in which I introduced one of three concepts which I still think to be most important in my writing so far. That was the idea of social becoming. How societies are able to transform themselves by their own power from below, by the popular movement, by the great leadership. We were lucky to have such leaders, Lech Wałęsa and another one, many of them, but Tadeusz Mazowiecki is a name which is today in all newspapers in Poland. He died yesterday at the age of 86, the first prime minister of free democratic Poland. Those great leaders who were able suddenly, in a very short time, to change the world completely. I have written a theoretical book about it, not about Poland, but about the mechanism of social becoming, how society can pull itself by its bootstraps, as Americans say, to do something impossible.
So
by popular power.
It sounds like practically you experienced certain challenges in terms of trying to get away from communist Poland, but then intellectually there was a whole other set of challenges that came with
and fantastic place to be and to look around and to see how it happens, because that was a unique experience, I think, in the history of Europe, even during the whole 20th century. And then another concept came. I realized that this great revolution is much more difficult than I believed before, because it's much easier to introduce political changes, economic changes, than to change human minds and to change culture. All those customs, all those ways of life, all those adaptive strategies which people have developed during the communist time were still in their heads, and it blocked quick adoption of Western ways, of the capitalist system, of the democratic participation. It was easy to change the law, but it was not easy to make people use democratic tools in order to influence power. So I introduced the concept of civilized competence, civilizational competence, as this set of mental and cultural necessities which must be change in order to have full-fledged transformation toward modern, democratic, free society.
I was going to say, we've kind of gotten this view of from your early youth and studies through all of these periods of transition in Poland. So could we come even maybe a little farther in history to 2002, when you became president of the ISA? And when you look back on that period, what were your goals for that presidency?
My career, so to say, in ISA started very early, in 1974 already, when I was at the Congress of ISA at Varna, Bulgaria, the only one so far in Eastern Europe. And since that time, I have attended all congresses of ISA, except one at Mexico City, because at that time, there was martial law in Poland. Solidarność was crushed. There was no way to get away, and nobody was allowed to go out.
Martial law was the only thing to keep you from the ISA.
Mexican Congress. Otherwise, I was quite active. I did something which I believe is important in ISA context already at the Congress of New Delhi, where together with Jeffrey Alexander, formerly of UCLA and presently at Yale, we decided to establish a committee, research committee on social theory. Mm-hmm. You would be surprised, but it was not existent before because of ideological opposition from the Soviet Union and the socialist or communist countries. And at that time already, there was a kind of change of...
Professor Stomko, what was the nature of the opposition to that?
Ideological, namely that social theory is something which is contradicting the findings of Marxism, Leninism, etc., etc., the communist ideology. That was considered dangerous. And there was some kind of opposition which led to establishing other research committees like history of sociology, which was more innocent, and methodology of social science, but not theory. Mm. We established a committee, RC16 now, which is now one of the biggest in the structure of ISA. And we initiated that through all those steps of working group, thematic group, etc., etc. Then at the Congress at Montreal, I was elected vice president for program. And in fact, program, content, has become my main preoccupation within ISA. I was interested in the quality of the ideas flowing around, I mean academic ideas. I had probably mistaken perspective in which I believed ISA is like an academy of science, like a purely academic institution. And I was partly successful because the program for the Congress at Brisbane which I worked out as a vice president, was good enough to elect me a president. People were so satisfied with the program that I was elected against five strong counter candidates. And then again, when I became a president, I was trying to follow the same persuasion, namely that we should seek for academic knowledge, for truth, for understanding the mechanisms of society, because there is nothing more relevant than truth, in my view. There is nothing more relevant than theory, practically relevant, because it is only when we have a wider picture, when we see the mechanisms of events, we may put to it to practice.
So, Professor Stonka, when, you know, listening to you, it's really, it's hard to imagine you being anything other than a sociologist, the way that you speak about theory and its capacity for making sense of the world. But when, the question that I'd like to end on today is, you know, when you look back over your life, which in your case, you know, you were trained as in your youth in music, having a father who's a distinguished concert pianist. You began studies in law, you dabbled a bit in the natural sciences, you've been, you know, an avid photographer for many years. You know, you have such kind of rich, varied interests. When you look back on your career, if you had not become a sociologist, what else do you think you might have liked to pursue?
You will be surprised. You will be surprised that when I think about it, well, I'm glad I am a sociologist. I'm satisfied with my life, with my achievements. I'm trying, of course, to push it further. I'm not ending my career by any means. And now I'm working again on some fascinating topics like visual culture, visual sociology, which you mentioned, but also I'm trying to put together some theory of interpersonal space, how this fundamental notion, which is at the heart of sociology, namely the networks of interpersonal relations, how they may be analyzed, and I try to put it together, various schools, etc. It's too long story for our talk. But so I'm happy to be sociologist, but probably there are two other occupations in which I would probably find satisfaction, and you would be surprised. One is the airline pilot of big commercial planes.
I'm actually not surprised,
yes.
The way you talk about the desire to go and
exactly,
to travel
exactly.
And explore.
But also the feeling of command. A feeling that I am in command of not only my life, but of the life of so many other people, that would be fascinating for me. And another probably has something to do with my family background, namely I would probably be not too bad orchestra conductor of the big orchestra, Chicago Symphony or Minnesota, or for that matter, you know, Philadelphia after Ormandy, something like that. You have that kind of dreams, but there is something which connects those two, namely an organization, the command of other people, and mobilizing them, in case of orchestra, of course, clearly, and synchronizing them and giving them some input in order to make the community better, community of players in this case, but community of my students, of my colleagues here at the university. I try to have some impact, you know.
Yes.
I try to have some impact because we leave the world, but many things may be still left, including our interview.
Yes, yes. Well, it's been a fascinating interview. Thank you so much for taking the time
Thank
today.
Thank you very much, Lale. It's
us.
Great pleasure. It's great pleasure talking to you, and I hope at least it will be interesting for somebody else, not only for yourself.
I'm sure it will be. Thank you so much.
All best.
This has been another Journey Through Sociology with Professor Piotr Stomka. You can find the whole entire series of interviews on the website of the International Sociological Association.